This is Professor Robin Feldman from the UC Hastings College of the Law in the United States and California. I am presenting an excerpt from my book, The Role of Science in Law, which was recently published by Oxford University Press. Now, the allure of science has always captivated members of the legal profession. We are constantly seduced into believing that science will provide answers to law's dilemmas, and we are constantly disappointed. What is most striking about this pattern is that we repeat it generation after generation in field after field of law with remarkable amnesia for our past failures. What I have tried to do in this work is to look at a pattern of law's repeated attempts to reach for science to solve its problems. I'm trying to talk about why such efforts fail and why it is a pattern that we repeat nevertheless. And finally, I want to talk a little bit about how to have a more effective law and science interface. Now, the work looks at two ways in which law tries to solve its problems through science. In one form, we try to import science into law. So when faced with difficult dilemmas, we try to solve the problem by taking a scientific line or a scientific category and placing it in the legal doctrine. After all, law has to develop lines and categories in some way. Why not borrow from scientific fields where there is at least some studied rational basis for the lines and groupings? Or we ask science to tell us something to measure, and then we place that measurement in the doctrine. This is one form, and I think of this as internalization or import of science into the legal doctrine. In another form, we try to export law's problems to science. That is, we endow scientific experts with the power to decide legal questions for us, and then the court will follow whatever the expert tells it. Thus, at times we try to import science into law, at other times we try to export law's problems to science. Both of these strategies frequently fail, but they are exquisitely revealing. They reflect a persistent image that law is weak and ineffective, in contrast to science, which is perceived as having the structure, the discipline to solve our problems. And it's these images, both of law and of science, that lead us to keep latching on to science to solve our problems. In fact, as I worked on this book, I was constantly reminded of how often this pattern appears, not just across time, but also in modern law. I picked up a New York Times Magazine article while I was writing, gushing about how historians of the future will look back on the 1990s as the moment when neuroscience began to, quote, transform the American legal system. And the article describes how researchers can now use brain scans to see what portions of the brain are activated by a particular person during a given activity. The article describes with great enthusiasm how this research will eventually allow the legal system to scientifically answer difficult questions, such as when individuals should not be held accountable for their actions, whether a particular person will engage in future criminal activity, and most important, we are told that these scans will answer the ever-elusive question of just what are our deeply shared beliefs upon which any legal system should be based. In other words, brain scans will tell us what the law in any particular area should be. Now, I also marvel at brain scan imagery and what it is teaching us in the field of science and what it is revealing in many different capacities, but I see the excitement about law and neuroscience as more of the same. If only science could give us categories, something to measure, or if we could find the right configuration of experts, law's problems would dissolve. Now, before we are swept away by the latest vision of how science will solve law's problems, I think it's worth thinking about our failures in the past in this realm. So let me take a minute at this point to talk about what I mean by science. The notion of what constitutes science and what it would take to make law more scientific varies across time and legal history. In this book, I use the term science quite broadly. I look at attempts to reach for physical sciences such as biology and botany, a as well as attempts to reach for social sciences such as psychology or economics. I believe this grouping is important for understanding what I call the instinct within law to look for the authoritative other. Now, American law has reached for many forms of authoritative other across the century to solve its problems, including history, philosophy, and theology. The dangers are particularly great, however, when the authoritative other is based on terms and concepts that legal actors don't have the expertise to interpret and to challenge and to adapt. And thus, I believe it's important to group both the physical sciences and the social sciences together to see how the problems emerge. Now, there are a number of examples in the book in which we turn to the physical and social sciences, sometimes quite explicitly and sometimes with less awareness. I'm going to go over some of these examples here. All of my work is based on American law, and those are the examples I will use here, but I hope that these are helpful for more general perspectives for those in other legal bases. I am most interested in the subtle examples because I think they reveal something about how we get into this pattern of reaching for science and why it is that these attempts to solve law's dilemmas are generally so unsuccessful. Because I believe these examples reveal a deep-seated discomfort and dissatisfaction with law's solutions to problems. It's an instinct to look for structures somewhere else that we can place within law and use as the doctrinal structures that we will follow. Of course, doctrinal structures in law are not enduring. There are no ultimate doctrinal structures in law because there are no ultimate questions. Those who wish to escape the constraints of any doctrinal structure are going to seek out the open spaces, the interstices between what has already been decided. And then the cases will naturally emerge within the spaces of whatever structure exists. It'll then render that structure insufficient for resolving what the new question is. So whatever structures we bring in, whatever structures we have, will never be final. So law is by nature evolutionary and adaptive. And when we borrow structures from science, that adaptive process tends to break down. And it does so for several reasons. The most obvious is that we don't understand the science that we are trying to import or apply, and therefore we don't allow it to evolve in a very effective or nuanced fashion. It's worse than that. We forget that scientific lines and constructs are themselves no more than just groupings. They create shared understandings within the scientific community, and they can help scientists talk about and explore a natural phenomenon. In a legal context, we lose sight of their artificiality and the assumptions that they embody. And again, the process of evolution and adaptation breaks down when we don't understand and think about all of the assumptions that are within what we've imported.